work is part of the research, that's what it comes into reality. The way I want to start is a picture. This is a picture of a digital model of San Francisco. And San Francisco is a great example of a city that is undergoing a very significant change. And the change is, if you just walk downtown San Francisco, you're going to see there's a lot of cranes, there's a lot of new construction that is happening. There's a lot of new architecture. And the change that is happening in San Francisco is not unique to the physical. It's happening in Los Angeles, and it's happening in other places around the world. For example, if you go, this is a picture, it's a little bit odd, but this is a picture taken in Shanghai, and also in Shanghai, in China in general, is seeing this complete change in the sense of instant life. And you know, the construction, the new construction that is happening, it's a new challenge, right? It's a new challenge, but it's also a new opportunity for designers, architects, and engineers alike to come up with new ideas, right? And it's a very daunting challenge because, you know, as an architect, and you know, you typically start from a just blank piece of paper, you know, an empty or something. You know, you can start with something that's completely white, you come up with an idea, right? So what's the best? What's a good idea? Well, there are good ideas there and there are bad ideas out there. But hopefully, you know, the way you come up with ideas is not this approach. You know, I don't know if you're familiar with this episode from The Simpsons. It's an excellent episode. And basically, Marge Simpson writes to this very famous architect asking him to design a new opera house for Springfield. So you see that architect, that he takes the letter from Marge Simpson and he says, well, and you forget it, I'm not going to do it. He takes the piece of paper and then he composites it and he throws it, you know, on the ground. And he looks at it and says, oh, you're a genius, you did it again. And you can see the resemblance between that piece of paper and then the design. Okay, so this is just an extreme and it's a caricature, obviously, of some design processes that may not make total sense, right? But there's a lot of processes that don't make sense out there. And unfortunately, there are also designs that are quite questionable, you know, in the sense of the lines or in the sense of the way you come up with the idea. And, you know, some of these designs that I don't favor personally, to me, you know, I don't like these designs because they lack a structural logic. So obviously my background, I'm a structural engineer, right? So there's a certain background I'm coming from, right? And I see, when I see a building, you know, I think about it in terms of an experience. A building is an experience in the sense that at the end of the day, it's gonna be lived. Someone is gonna live there. Someone is gonna work there. Someone is gonna do something inside that building. The building is not just an object to look at. Otherwise, it's a piece of art. And then you can just work and you have work, and then you have an object, you just look at it and, you know, it's great, but it's different. A building, and that's the reason why you guys are called architects, you know, artists, but it is an experience, right? So we need to think about the integrative aspect of the design. So it's not only about the aesthetic qualities, but it's also about structural engineering, it's about services, it's about, you know, your air conditioning, it's about elevators, it's about stairs, it's about beams, columns, it's about a number of things, right? So, you know, and when you think about design, there's another thing to consider nowadays, is sustainability, right? I mean, it's not only, you know, coming up with a great design idea, it's also coming up with an idea that is from you know, ecological point of view, sustainable. Take the example of stadiums, right? Stadium. So there are a lot of stadiums that have been built around the world, right? But what about their carbon footprint? You know, what about the material that they are using in order to build this stadium, okay? So this is a chart that we have here that basically kind of collects some of the major examples of stadiums around the world. So for example, the Beghini Arena, the Alliance Arena, you know, and then you have the Beijing Olympic Stadium. And you can clearly see that there is, I mean, think about it. Does it make sense that on average, to build a stadium, you need 2,000 kilograms per seat, right, roughly, okay? That's a good design. Then all of a sudden you have this pipe, which is 15,000. Okay, so instead of building this stadium, you could have built 7 stadiums. Okay, so you should start wondering, I mean, does it make sense, you know? And just because, you know, just because you can do it, should you do it, right? Should you design something that uses so much resources, right, and so much, carbon footprint, obviously, for a stadium on Elite is huge. It's 7 times as much as a normal stadium. So what happened to good, sound, structural principles for design? So who are my heroes? I mean, who do I look up to? So the people I look up to, they belong to probably the 1900s. You know, there's been great designers you know, structural engineering, but are also well regarded from an architectural point of view. These great designers are by the name, you know, Piero Luigi Nervi, Robert Maillard, you have Heinz Isler, Felix Candela, Fry Otto. So these engineers did something really great with structure and with forms. And you can clearly see, you know, I mean, they started from very, very simple mechanics principles, but they were able to build something that was also beautiful from an architectural point of view. And so this is really, these are great examples, you know, what, you know, someone, in my opinion, a structure engineer, you should look up to. And, you know, these structures are not like fancy, like structures, very, you know, flashy, but they're simple, actually. As a matter of fact, you find this shell, you know, this Heinz Isler shell, it's in the middle of nowhere in Switzerland. It's a gas station, okay? It's very, very simple, very utilitarian, they say, okay? But it's nothing, you know, but it serves the purpose. You know, they were looking for simplicity and for, you know, practicality in the construction and also minimization of material quantities. So, very beautiful structures that, you know, are very utilitarian. Also, this bridge also is very difficult to find. It's another Maillard bridge, the Saginaw bridge. It connects very small villages in the middle of Switzerland. And, you know, very utilitarian structures, so beautiful structures. So what happened? You know, why in the 1900s we were here, and then all of a sudden there's been these explosions of forms, you know, of all kinds of geometries. Well, computation happened, you know. You have a lot of computational tools nowadays, right? You know, there's no need to name any software specifically. You know, and you know, I took this from one of the big people. I thought it was a great idea. But anyway, with these tools, with this software, you know, you guys can morph, can push, can pull, you can do all kinds of stuff, right? You can even, you know, you can write scripts, you can optimize, you can, you know, there's other things you can do. The problem is that the form you're creating in a three-dimensional software, they're not necessarily logical from a structural point of view. They lack the structural input, right? So just because you can draw something, you can model something, doesn't mean that that form is going to be optimal or efficient, right? So how do we step back from that? Well, first of all, I'm not against technology. I think technology is fantastic, it's phenomenal, okay? As a matter of fact, I mean, technology inspires design, right? Otherwise, think about, you know, the way we used to think about cars, okay? And think about an Italian, a Ferrari, right? Or a Lamborghini, if you want to. But, you know, beautiful, fantastic forms, fantastic line of design, fantastic performance, right? And that performance is achieved through technology, and the way we develop through technology. Same thing with bicycles, or with, you know, with ships. So technology is important, is how you use the technology. So the best way, from my perspective, to use the technology is to use it in a way that helps us understanding. Okay? You need to gain understanding in what you're designing, in what you want to design, in what you want to do with your design. Think about it, you know, in these terms, right? I think that the idea of a magnet is actually quite powerful. So in a magnet, when you have a magnet, right, there are magnetic lines around it, right? There is an electromagnetic field, right? Do you see it? You don't. But the fact that you don't see it, it doesn't mean that it's not there, right? It's only the power of visualization, right? For example, think about mechanics, right? You can visualize displacement. I can say, okay, I'm going to move these from here to there. That's my displacement. You can visualize strain. I can compress this bottle and I can strain it. But I bet you, how do you see forces? Can you see forces? You see them. You cannot visualize it because we are limited, right, by our capabilities of seeing something. So the key thing is, how do you visualize something you're really curious about? As an engineer, you want to know what the force is, right? I mean, what are the forces? What are you designing for? Is foreign object forces. So how do we visualize them? Well, in a magnet, you get creative, you use iron filings, right? And all of a sudden, all these patterns emerge, right? And you can see, and you can do something about it. Same thing, you can do it with forces. Suppose that you use one of these powerful software, and you have your building, right? Your building is just a rectangle, it's fixed at the base, and then you have lateral forces applied to it, right? And suppose that you want to distribute the material in your building in the best possible way, okay? So you put the material where you want it, so that the building is as stiff as it can be. So this software, that's what the software allows you to do, visualizing the forces and placing the material where you want it to be. So blue means I don't need any material. Red means I need a lot of material here because that's where the best place for it is going to be. Okay? So by using this software, which is part of this field of structural optimization, which is a very general term to name a collection of techniques at the end of the day, this is just one of them, you know, you start discovering new geometries. So for example, as I said, if you start from this domain, this fixed of the day, you have this lateral load, you have these geometries, and in these geometries, you start understanding patterns of optimality. What's a good idea and what's a bad idea? Meaning you start also educating your intuition of what's better and what's worse. In this case, for example, the interesting thing about this pattern, and the reason why I'm showing it is because it's related to the design, I'm going to show you later. The interesting thing about this pattern is that the location of this brace is not in the middle of the module, okay? When you think about X bracing, typically you think about, oh yeah, the work point is going to be in the middle. But in this case, actually you realize that the middle is not necessarily the optimal location for that brace. And it kind of makes sense from an engineering point of view when you start studying a little bit the details of it. Because, you know, if you think about, you know, the high-rise problem, right? You know, for the engineers in the room, okay, you have shear walls, right? You're familiar with shear walls, columns, beams. When you have a shear wall, okay, the name is unfortunate because it's called shear wall, so you think about shear. But actually, a shear wall is not only working a shear, it's working also in bending, okay? If it were to be a shear problem, sure. If it were pure shear, it would be an X, no problem. But it's not true, it's not pure shear. It is the problem at the top, it's a cantilever problem where you have shear and bending combined. And therefore, there has to be a bias in the location of the work point, which wants to be a little bit higher than the middle, okay? And so that makes sense, you know? I mean, you saw a numerical result, and at the same time, you come up with a mechanical explanation of it in a simple fashion, right? In a simple explanation. And so this, you know, this is very useful. This is very useful information, but, you know, okay, how do we use this information, okay? So let's take an example. I'll show you one example of a building in Shenzhen. Okay. Shenzhen is located about 30 kilometers away from Hong Kong. Hong Kong is right about here. So the best way to get to Shenzhen is you fly to Hong Kong and then you drive 30, 40 kilometers to Shenzhen. There is a bay there, so it's actually quite beautiful. The site, the location of the site is very nice. You have by the water, it's really quite beautiful. And Shenzhen is another example of a place, of a city, that is undergoing a significant change in China. 10 years ago, Shenzhen was a village of fishermen, pretty much, and nowadays, I mean, it's just high-rise, booming all over the place. As a matter of fact, if you listen to the news from time to time, they talk about China, especially you know, the past few months, they talk about China a lot, Chinese stock market. They always talk about the Shanghai Index and the Shenzhen Index, that's Shenzhen. Shenzhen is kind of, they have a lot of tech companies, so it's like the Silicon Valley of China, so there's a lot of obviously money and investment there, so it's growing very, very quickly. So the location on our site, I mean, the client came to us, I mean, there was an open competition, a design competition. They said, we want to develop two towers, two relatively tall towers. One is 300 meters, the other one is 200 meters. The 300 meters is about 1,000 feet. And then we want to have a podium with retail, and also we're going to have a basement, four-level basement. So you guys come up with a design, right? So at the beginning, you know, we work with the architects, so we are fortunate that SOAN, we are multidisciplinary, so we have structural engineers and we have architects working together. And so the architects, they were aware of our research and what we were doing, and so they came up to us and said, oh, okay, how can you guys come up with an idea for one of these buildings, for these buildings? I said, well, so let's take what we learned from, you know, the analysis I showed you at the beginning. How can we use that idea in an actual building, okay? So as I said previously, you know, these results, these numerical results, cannot be taken at face value. Meaning you cannot just take that and apply to a building. You need to interpret it. So you need an engineer to kind of infer the geometric principle behind that design to apply to a much broader idea. So if you take this logic, okay, you understand that there are some underlying geometric principles that allow you to write, say, a Python script or something like Grasshopper. And the script would allow you to create layouts of different densities. Now, these layouts actually are relatively simple because there's only one parameter controlling this layout. And the parameter is this angle. Because the rule of optimality is that all these lines, for example, this angle is 90 degrees and this angle is 90 degrees for all of them. So 90 degrees, 90 degrees, and so on and so forth. So the sum of these three angles is 90 degrees, right? So you have only one angle that is unknown, which is this one. Right? So there's only one parameter describing that geometry. It's a different angle for this geometry and this geometry and that geometry, but it's one parameter. So we said, why don't we take these two different densities, obviously different densities relate to different programs. Again, I mean, building as experience, as integrated design. So there is a program here, office, it could be retail, it could be hotel. Let's take these two ideas and let's apply them. So we took the first idea, which was this layout over here. Then we said, okay, we need to stretch it, okay? Because we have a program to satisfy, we need to stretch it. So that's what we did with the first one. And this is what we did with the second one. We took the two layouts side by side, and then we stretched them again, and we came up with the design. So in the context of the city, and you can see them here. So this is the first tower, which is the taller tower, which is 1,000 meters tall. 300 meters tall, 1,000 feet. And this is 200 meters. And then there is the four level of retail and commercial sector. So this is how we applied those ideas in this context. Okay. And you can see here, as I said, there's always a certain program that you have to account for. One tower is mainly the office, and there is a portion of luxury condos, and there is the hotel, and there is the whole Soho portion of top. Soho is like a service office. And then you have the lower lower level building, which is more like free-time. So I'm just going to show you a few like renderings, so you can get a sense of the design. Again, I mean, these are from the water, from the Shenzhen Bay at night, which is quite nice. And this is a view basically from underneath. There is a sunken plaza and looking up to the design over the tower. And the fascinating aspect is that we avoided completely vertical elements, so we have no columns. There's no columns. Anyway, there's no vertical elements, it's all diagonal all the way around. We have a special geometry, and we can see here from the bottom going to the top. And these are the views from inside. So again, thinking of what was saying within the experience, how would you experience if you were inside the building, not from the outside? So if you look from inside out, what do you see? Because I mean, you have to think about it, right? You're actually going to live inside the building. So from the inside, actually, you have these beautiful views, especially to the south, where you have the chandelier and water. And in particular, these fans are pretty generous. We are talking about 20 meters. 20 meters is about 60 feet. So 60 feet without any columns, which is pretty fantastic. All open glass, so very transparent coming into the water. And you can see here that there's not really a module per se, but you know, the diagonals are relatively sparse, so that allow you to build your own module. And also the lobby, you know, because all these diagonals collect into the corner, there is no columns whatsoever into the lobby, which creates this very open space. So this is the space from the inside, there's no columns. So everything ends up in the corner, which is really quite beautiful from an architectural point of view to be able to achieve that.
May I ask a question or should I wait until the end?
Let's wait until the end.
Yeah, oh, sorry. So just going through a couple of details. So let's go through a couple of drawings. How many engineers are in the room? Oh, that's a lot. That's good. All right, so we can talk a little bit about the technical aspects of the tower. So there's a couple of elevations here. This is a front elevation. This is an elevation from 45 degrees. So you actually see two faces, okay, on the side. And then you can see here basically the corner detail where you have a number of diagonals coming into this point. So you can imagine from a construction point of view, there is a certain complexity in the joint. At the same time, there is a lot of force because you are carrying all the force that in your perimeter down to four points. And so this needs to transfer into what is a wall pier, a concrete pier with embedded steel shapes in it, which then goes down all the way to the foundation, which is a mat foundation on piles. And the piles are anchored into the rock. There is pretty solid rock, so that wasn't a problem for us. But obviously, it could be a problem on a different site if you have very concentrated loads and your soil is not okay. There is several level of basements, as I mentioned, 4 to 5 level of basement, depending upon where you are. Also, the stuff with the lateral system, you have these two diagrams. Now, you can see that there is not a single corner column, it's two split corner columns, because there is the site has very high winds and very high seismic. So what happens is that you need to be able to dissipate energy. But because of the way these geo- geometry is derived is optimal, meaning it's very stiff. It's extremely stiff, which from a seismic point of view is not a good thing, right? Because you want ductile elements from a seismic point of view. So we put ductile element where we needed them. And therefore, these links that you have in between the two corner columns are actually dissipation elements, meaning if your earthquake comes, what that means is that there is a locking mechanism between the two faces of the diagram such that those links are going to heal and they're going to dissipate energy. Together with what happened in the core, we still have the core that dissipates energy. Now, looking at the floor plan, this is the architectural floor plan and this is the structural floor plan. You still have a dual system per se, meaning you have a concrete core and you have a perimeter frame on the outside. It is a composite system, so you have a reinforced concrete core. You have a composite floor system with steel beams spanning between the core and the perimeter with a metal deck. And then you have concrete fill tubes in the perimeter. Okay? So these are steel shapes which are filled with concrete, which gives the stiffness to the building. And you can see here the corresponding architectural layout. How does the architectural layout for the architects in the room has to account for all the vertical transportations, has to account for typically in the core, you put mechanical rooms, electrical rooms, your stairs are there, and then you can have all the vertical vertical situations element. Typically, this is the less desirable space, so you could, for office space, you would put toilet, or you put other functions that are not like predominant functions, which happens on the outside. Now, there are special levels as you go up the tower, which are called nodal levels. The nodal levels is where you have the intersections between diagonal members, which create a node, which creates a joint. That level has high forces, right? Because all the forces need to travel through that joint. So this special level, they typically have a lot of bracing, to the node itself, so that it cannot pass a lot of current, so it's locked in. And then as you go up the building, you'll notice that the amount of shear walls that we are carrying is less and less, because what happens in this system, the perimeter is so stiff that it's carrying the majority of the lateral walls. So typically in a dual system, what you have is the majority of the lateral walls is in the core as opposed to the perimeter. Okay? Typically, the 80 to 90% of the load is in the core. In this system, which is innovative and unique per se, actually 80 to 90% is in the perimeter. So it's the exact opposite. It's completely the opposite. And but the advantage of it is that you can minimize the amount of core walls and you can just put a lot of openings into your core, especially high up where you have the most valuable area that you can sell, right? So this is the most profitable area and that's where you have the least amount of shear walls. Now, again, from a design point of view, you have relatively high seismic. If you're not familiar with the Chinese code, in China, you can go up to seismic intensity 9. 9 is the highest, typically in areas like Beijing, for example, is extremely high seismic. Shenzhen is high up and not too high, so it's medium high seismic. But from a wind point of view, it's extremely high. Because you also have typhoons, so you can have typhoons, and that obviously has to be accounted for in the design. Obviously, we had to do a wind tunnel test, so we run several tests, and to come up with the design forces for the tower. Now, we build several numerical models, so after the initial design, the initial conceptual shred, then obviously it comes into all the detail and all the analysis work that has to go into the design of the building. So we typically use the three-dimensional finite-element software in order to come up with the dimensionality of the elements, of your core walls, and the diagonals, and all the different structural components. Here you can see the system split into what the perimeter frame is, so it's actually a frame system, diagonal frame, and then you have your shear walls. And typically you also model the areas around the foundation in order to measure the flexibility of the base of the building, so how much movement there's going to be in the base itself. We did just to give you a sense of the dimensionality of all the different members. If you consider the core walls, these are the thicknesses of the core walls per se. This is the outer wall, is like in the 800 millimeter thick, and the interior wall is in the 400 millimeter thick. Just to give you a sense of scale, what's the impact of optimization? How do you see it? Well, you would see it because for a building of this height, okay, 300 meters, typically this would be 1.2 meters. So this is 30% less thick because it's optimal. And so it's not, you're not talking about 2%, 3%, you're talking about 20 to 30% savings in material if you can use this technique, this optimization technique. And that's very significant. Because if I can make a wall, instead of the wall being like 4 foot or 5 foot thick, it's 3 foot thick, right? It's a huge difference. Think about it, I mean, every foot that I reduce the wall is visible area, is more area that you can sell for. It's very significant. And think about the carbon footprint. We were talking about sustainability earlier, right? You want to minimize the amount of concrete you want to use. So that's the route you want to go for. Okay? And then these are the typical size of the corner columns and the perimeter diagonal. So you're talking about, you know, these members are not huge. The biggest member is this big and is 1,000 foot tall structure. I mean, it's very reasonable size. There is a lot of details in the analysis. I would love to talk about this. We could take hours and hours to talk about the different aspects of it. What I think I would do, I would just touch upon some highlights. Okay? But if you have questions later, you can ask me any question you're interested in. From a dynamic point of view, the dynamic behavior is very well behaved. In particular, there is good separation between the first and third wall. That's the typical separation we want to get for achieving comfort within the structure. It's a very stiff structure, you have it in 5 seconds. Structure of this hut will be in the range of 6 to 6.5 seconds, so it's much, much stiffer. And you have this good separation with the torsion. Another aspect that I already mentioned, the core is doing very little for you. All the loads is mostly in the perimeter, and that's actually what you want it, because it's more efficient, right? And the stiffest is where we have, you know, the highest moment of inertia, so you want the material as far away from the neutral axis as you can. And therefore, that's what you achieve. This is a diagram that shows you the shear, you know, at a different height, the percent of shear that is in the frame and the percent of shear that is in the core. Just as a frame of reference, at the base of the building, the percent of shear that is taken by the frame is 70%. So the majority of the load is actually in the frame as opposed to being in the core, as I mentioned earlier. The other thing is that is interesting about this building is that if you're familiar with the tube system, like a tube lateral system, this is actually not a tube system. And you know, one thing that became a problem during the peer review process, we had a peer review, you guys familiar with the design in the US, design internationally. Typically, for buildings of a certain height, you cannot just design the building and they go and build it, okay? You need to have a peer review process, meaning there's another company that comes, okay, reviews your documents and your design and says, yeah, this is good. Maybe you should think about, you know, studying this problem. You might have that problem. So they peer review your work, right? It's good for everyone, for the client, for us, for everyone, and for safety. So in the peer review process, the first thing that they ask you, what is your lateral system? You have to define it, right? So in the US code, you have, it can be a moment frame, a shear wall system, it can be a tube system. You have several definitions. Well, this doesn't fit any of those classification. And you, when you start working in this, you know, this optimization like optimal forms, this comes across because you're coming across unconventional systems. Right? So this is unconventional and it's not a tube. So this was the first issue we had to resolve. But these are basically four planes, okay, four stiff planes acting independently. As a matter of fact, suppose that you take your lateral force and you apply it to your building. If it were to be a tube system, you would see high forces on the faces that are orthogonal to that load, okay? You will see very high axial forces here in what we call the flanges, okay? We use typically a beam analogy, flanges and web, okay, for the building itself. You will see high forces in the two flanges and very little forces in the two webs. This is the exact opposite. You have a lot of forces in the webs and very little forces in the flanges because those corners are split. You don't have a one corner column, you have two corner columns that are split, and so the stiffness of those links is not enough to transfer the shear leg across and engage the flanges. Okay? So this is another uniqueness of this lateral system. I can talk a little bit about energy dissipation. You know, energy dissipation is a big concern in seismic events. If you run a nonlinear analysis, nonlinear seismic analysis under, you know, you basically take your building, you shake it, you know, under a seismic event. You take your seismic wave, you shake it, then you analyze all the different energies. There is strain energy, damping energy, there is kinetic energy, and there is dissipated energy, which is very little. So the issue that we have, you know, in seismic design, maybe it's not as, you know, the East Coast is not as prominent, but when you go to the West Coast or, for example, in Asia, you know, the issue of seismicity is very important. Okay? And so, but it's also very important the concept of resiliency. Okay, so think about an earthquake, right? And you shake your building. It's true that you want to dissipate energy, but you also don't want to dissipate too much. Suppose that after an earthquake, your building is completely, I mean, it stands, it didn't collapse, but it's totally devastated. Like, you have cracks everywhere, you need to replace all your beams, or you need to do a lot of work. You need to shut down the building, right? And then you shut down all the companies that are working in that building. So you cannot shut down a building after a major seismic event for a long time. So it's not enough to say, oh, my building is okay because it doesn't collapse. That's not good enough. I mean, it has to be such that you can go back to work in a reasonable period of time, right? So that's the reason why you do want some energy dissipation, but not too much. Okay, and this is a tough balance to achieve. I mean, how much is too much and how little is too little? Okay. So this building was what we call essentially elastic, which means there is some energy dissipation, but not too much. Okay, because by the nature of it is elastic, and it wants to be elastic. So issues of seismicity. So I'm going to skip a few slides here just to bring another highlight. The last highlight I wanted to touch upon is the connection, because you can imagine that, right, one of the main feature of the whole structure is really this connection and how they come together, because they're very complex, right? You have different types of connections along the height of the building. You have connections that might have four members, here you have five members coming together, okay, because you have the corner columns which just flip, and then you have three diagonals. You have members that are different angles. You have very steep angles, very shallow angles. So every connection is kind of unique, okay, in this building. There is not, you know, it's true, I mean, this connection is mirrored to that connection, then it repeats four times around, but there is certain complexity. So there was a lot of work that was done with the fabricator, the metal fabricator, to understand how to detail this connection, right? So I'm just going to show you one, which is this corner connection out here. Because it's the most complicated when you have the three diagonal coming to the corner column. First of all, the corner column is not a regular shape, it's an irregular shape. It has to be because you have those links in the corner that wants to meet orthogonal to this face, and you want these diagonals to meet orthogonal to that face. So you have two faces, right? You kind of need to split the difference of those angles. So, and you can imagine as you go up high, those faces are changing. So the shape of this column is changing as you go higher up in the building. At the same time, you have these diagonals coming in, and you need a gusset plate to collect those three columns into one column and transfer into a system below grade, which is concrete plus steel. Okay? And then you're going to have stiffness inside. You're going to have to account for fillet, you know, radiuses, a number of welds that have to be accounted for. So we developed all these. Also keeping in mind that these are concrete field, so you cannot put too much steel in it. So all your stiffness has going to have openings in it. So it was a very complicated fabrication interaction with the fabricator. And we did a lot of analysis as well, obviously. I mean, there was a lot of high-end finer analysis that we did in these connections, modeling the steel, modeling the concrete inside the steel. And you know, typically these are the results you will get. There's a lot of contour plots that tells you how much you're utilizing your material in terms of steel or in terms of concrete, and how you want to minimize display differences, right? So also here you can use optimization techniques in order to size the members, but obviously it's not as, you know, as more of a global optimization technique. It's much more local in the sense that you're just optimizing the thickness, it's not the overall geometry of your structure. And like we analyzed this connection, we analyzed the number of this connection. These again, contour plots for the stresses in the concrete in these connections, and the cracking. This means cracking, so it means that there is tension in the concrete, so they're going to have some tensile stresses that are going to crack. These are the concrete piers that are below grade. Also, those are significantly correct. So, as I said, I mean, we analyzed a number of these connections, out here. This is just, I showed you just that, I'll show you just highlights of the design. As mentioned earlier, I mean, I would love to talk more about the design, but I know that we have limited time here. So with that, I just wanted to thank you and just leave you with just a few concluding thoughts. One thought is that, you know, these optimization techniques are very powerful, and they can be applied in a number of instances and architectural situations, and they can give you very interesting designs. Okay? This is just one example that I showed you, and it's a design that actually is going to get built. And so it's one of the, maybe hopefully one of many designs that are going to be built based on these techniques and based on these ideas. And I hope that, you know, this could be beginning of inspiration for you and to think about how you could, you know, in your practice and in your work, you could apply some of these ideas. And with that, thank you very much, and if you have any questions. No, we didn't. Actually, those are steel beams. So for a 20-meter span, you can do it with a meter deep beam. So it would be your W36 can span 60.
And in the concrete, any special additives like natural sulfonates?
No, because the system actually, the concrete itself in the slab, you mean?
Yeah.
You heard about the slab. So the slab itself is not spanning very far because the system is a one-way system. So you have the steel beam spanning between the core and the perimeter of the spandrel. But the steel beams are spaced at 3 meters on center, so they're 10 feet on center. So that span is just metal there. It's just
thank you.
Yeah, sure.
I was sort of wondering if you did what you were designing as an analysis of just the equivalent buildings and sort of basic SOM core construction and saw the cost differences or material differences, or is this just a material and design decision and it doesn't work quite on cost yet?
No. Well, the cost question is very complex because, you know, in the cost, there is usually in the building, the majority, a lot of the cost is usually in the curtain wall. But the curtain wall typically is the majority of the cost. However, for, as a structural engineer, the only cost we can control is really the cost of material, cost of, a formwork or cost of steel. So we did check, we compared this building to a more conventional building, say core plus perimeter more. Actually, it ended up being that this was cheaper by about 10 to 20% material-wise, structural material-wise.
Yes. Labor in the
structure. Well, also, the question of labor is very complex.
Right. Obviously, it's because,
well, I mean, depending on where you are, there's different labor costs. That's just, so, yes.
Okay, but like the labor cost of doing those joints, sort of casting and making those joints versus that, how much does that add back to cost?
Yeah, that one, we didn't go as deep as the because we started first at the material. Obviously, the joints have sort of complexity to them.
Is the distortion of the pattern as it goes up, is that a primarily visual reason, or was there a structural or load reason for that?
So, you mean the stretching? Yeah. So, it was more a programmatic issue related to the program, because as you go up towards the top, it becomes a service apartment. So the service apartments have more of a modular, you know, they require more of a modular spacing, right? The problem with typically this kind of system is that you don't have a module. So office spaces, for example, that, you know, you can subdivide the office spaces as you want. If the whole floor is office, you know, what is a diagonal, it doesn't really matter. But if you are high up in the building and you're in a one bedroom unit and your window has a diagonal in it, you lose a lot of the visual, right? So for that reason, we decided to go up to morph the pattern so that towards the top it was more vertical. So we could control, you know, because that is much steeper, you know, if you can separate the units better by doing that. And to your point also, you know, you could argue that, you know, we came up with an optimal geometric pattern structurally, right? And then all of a sudden you stretch it. So what is your optimality, right? Excellent point. So here's the thing, there is a big difference between if you start from a random point and if you start from an optimal point. Okay, if you start from something that is optimal, the optimal, your function is very flat. Okay, you can prove it. It's very flat. So if you start from an optimal point and then you do simple geometric manipulations, you move away from the optimum, not too much. Your inefficiency in terms of material might be 3-4%, okay, if you move away. So you can do it. It's a legitimate operation. However, if you start from something that is not optimal, it's totally random, you're never going to get to an optimal. I mean, it's a very different perspective.
Are there any questions? I think you can not answer them off the top of your head, though.
Okay.
Aren't any questions? For centuries, ship structures have required your discipline, that is, efficiency of structure, because everything that is not structure is machinery or load or fuel. I know what ship scantlings look like, and I wonder if you brought your discipline to ship structures where the ships would look very different. The other question, Eiffel's tower. If you brought your discipline to a redesign, a functional redesign of Eiffel's tower, would it look very different or somewhat different or quite the same? And final question.
Okay, that's a very good point. As far as the ship industry goes, I wouldn't know. But I have to tell you this, that these techniques, they don't come from the structural engineering industry. They actually come from the mechanical engineering aerospace. You know, so they were first used, the initiator of this whole field has been aerospace and aeronautical engineering. Because obviously, if you put an airplane in the air, you want to minimize the weight. You want to minimize the material. So everything has a reason to be in the air. And so aerospace engineers are the masters of these optimization techniques. Same thing with mechanical engineering, cars, car components. Mostly of, you know, the software I showed you, you know, most of the clients are from the high end, you know, Ferrari, Lamborghini, or Airbus, you know, those are all clients that use this kind of software. I would suspect that the shipping industry might take great advantage of these techniques. Unfortunately, I'm not as familiar with it, but I would think that like high end, like, you know, Team Oracle, or, you know, the kind of very, very high end ship from the marine industry, definitely take advantage of this.
Do you enter the very similar ship structure?
Yes.
Very similar to aircraft fuselage structure.
Yeah, it's true, because it's a similar problem, right? I mean, it's you're dealing with the fluid, it's just the density of the fluid is different. So density of air is density of water. So yeah, hydrodynamics as opposed to aerodynamics, you know, it's still a similar problem. It's just that, you know, you're dealing with different kind of Reynolds numbers, you're dealing with liquid, so laminar flow as opposed to flow, it's turbulent flow, turbulence. But there are similarities also. And same thing with cars, you're dealing with aerodynamics. I definitely see the option of using the condition. As for the second question, I mean, the Eiffel Tower, I think, is a beautiful example of engineering. It's a great example. Would it look different? I mean, I would, I don't know. The lines of the Eiffel Tower, I don't recall exactly the kind of lines, but in a sense, you know, they remind me of more of a, you know, parabolic line, right, which would respond more to a wind and uniform pressure and optimization for a moment. So it reminds me of a moment. The difference with these techniques is that you can ask yourself the question, what are you optimizing for? Right? So I'm not sure, you know, depending upon what you're optimizing for, you can have different theories, right? And maybe one of those forms could be a felt form. But obviously, if your objective, because your objective could be, I want to optimize so that you achieve the maximum stiffness. But you could optimize so that you achieve a certain frequency. Or you could optimize to for backlog, because I want to maximize my backlog capacity. But you could optimize to achieve a constant force on the outer member of your Eiffel Tower. Right? You want to achieve a constant force, your profile, your geometry is going to look different. They're all different questions. Right? And for every question, there's a different answer. That's the beauty of, you know, using this tool.
Thank you.
Sure, thank you.
The peaks in between the perimeter columns, you said that they were designed to yield for energy dissipation?
Yeah.
Okay. Was there ever any concern about after a major seismic event and you come back in to replace the links with a new one?
Yeah, that's the reason why what I was mentioning is a good point. There was that consideration because, as I was mentioning, obviously if you completely damage, and this is what relates, I don't know if you guys studied the different levels of seismicity, the United States, they call it collapse prevention, there is immediate occupancy, life safety, right? Obviously, collapse prevent, what are these limits? These limits, they kind of relate how much rotation you have in a beam to how much is the degree of damage in your structure, right? The more rotation you have, the more your beam is totally just really strong when you have to replace it. So if you can control these limits, these drift limits, you know, basically the damage is very minor. So our limit was immediate occupancy. So if you think about it, it's yielding, immediate occupancy is merely after life safety, collapse prevention. So we are very far away. The collapse prevention may be 8 radians. I mean, the immediate occupancy might be like 2 times the yielding rotation. So it's going to spoil. So if there were even a major seismic event, they could go back relative after an inspection, making sure everything is okay, you don't have to do major repairs.
Diagonal bracing systems, I think, were first introduced in the 60s, like the Hancock Tower in Chicago. And it seems to me that they were quite satisfactory in their performance, but they don't seem to be very popular.
That's really interesting. I don't know. I'm not sure why they're not. I mean, the Hancock Tower is an excellent building. We come from the faculty comes and school talk. They're becoming more popular. I think nowadays you can see more diagonal. For example, Bank of China, Hong Kong, you know, there's, you can see more of them, you know. But the tricky part about that, usually the criticism about diagonal, the main criticism is programmatic, meaning they cause problems in the modules and diagonals. Now, for a building like the Hancock, you know, I lived in Chicago for a long time, you know, if you have actually the apartments that have the diagonal are the most valuable. Yeah, because, you know, it's the feature of the building, right?
Because there's a top, and the density increases at the top. When you target
the top. Well, for the Hancock itself, you know, it's just an X bracing as you go up. But, you know, because it's so peculiar, the form, everyone recognizes the Hancock for those diagonals. Nowadays, they're actually the most valuable unit, the one with the diagonal. But, you know, I would argue that if you have one bedroom or a studio, a room with the diagonal in the middle, but I think that they're efficient buildings, they're efficient structures. The other criticism to diagonal typically is they're very stiff, right? Because they're so highly diagonalized, they're very stiff, and so in seismic areas, you have a very hard time with the panel review, with the peer review, to get it accepted. Because then they ask you, okay, what's your ductility? Well, there's no ductility, it's elastic. And then you have to design for elastic at a very large earthquake, the MC, your maximum credible earthquake. So you have to design for a much higher criteria in order to, you know, to satisfy this requirement. It's just a thought. You know, it's both design, it's a design issue, and at the same time, it's, there's some resistance sometimes.
One more question. Okay.
Sorry. Because the building is so stiff, was there any ever large concerns about non-structural damage during a seismic event, like because the building's so stiff, just things shaking off the walls, TVs and stuff, or because you have those ductile links, if that was enough to just sort of curb?
Yeah, no, there was consideration about the structural damage. And again, I mean, by controlling your rotations, I mean, at the end of the day, we took a look and it's not really a significant issue. Typically, what would happen, no matter what happened, it depends on how you detail what your non-structural components are. For example, your partition points, right? Suppose you have a partition. It depends typically. Okay, you can tie the partition walls at the floor, but for example, at the ceiling, obviously you need to have some joints. Obviously, if you lock in the partitions at the top and the bottom, even not without a seismic event, you're gonna have a problem just for wind, right? So it really depends. It's all on the detailing of the issues. But it's an important issue. As a matter of fact, typically, you know, when you get sued for something, you don't get sued because there is a major structural issue. Typically, it's because there's something in the non-structural component that doesn't work. There are cracks in the partition walls. Those are very common problems that people usually don't pay attention to. But those are the most critical because you need to live in that place. If you have your office and your partition walls that I'm not as familiar with that. I don't think that we gave any specific special consideration from that point of view. I just not completely familiar. Thank you.
All right, Alessandro, this has been super fascinating. Thank you so much.
They're building it. They're doing the foundation. It's very challenging schedule.